So coming back to the presentation, here I highlighted the implementation part to say to you that the implementation part is managed by an Ansible playbook, the one that I have just shown you. So what is Ansible? Ansible is a configuration management and provisioning tool. It's very similar to other configuration management tools like Puppet, Salt, or Chef. The main difference with respect to these other software is that Ansible is agentless. It simply uses SSH by default to make the connection to the nodes, but can be also run locally. The scripts are written in YAML. And it is very easy to learn. In fact, it is used by many user communities because it is very simple to move from a bash script, that is the common way in which users try to make the installation of their software automatic. It's very simple to move from a bash script to an Ansible recipe. The building blocks of Ansible are a playbook that defines sequences of tasks called plays that have to be executed on a group of hosts. The group of hosts are in general defined in a specific file called inventory. So in an inventory file you can define with a label different groups of hosts, for example web servers, and then you can put the list of IPs of the hosts where the web server configuration will be applied. Then you can put another label with another set of IPs of another group of hosts that will be configured as, batch front-end, and so on. So in the inventory file, you define the group of hosts to be configured. The playbook describes policies that the machines under management shall enforce, can contain variables, tasks, handlers, files, templates, and roles. Is expressed in YAML, and here you can find an example playbook. In this example playbook, we are defining the tasks that are needed to install an Apache web server, a web server based on Apache. So you can see that there is a first section where the variables are defined, and then a list of tasks that are commands. So here we are using YUM to install HTTPD. Here we are writing the Apache configuration file using a template file. Here we are notifying, this is an handler, this is called an handler, because we are notifying to restart the Apache service because we are modified its configuration. And then finally we ensure that Apache is running using systemd, quindi service HTTPD started. The playbooks are idempotent. This is an important feature of Ansible because we can rerun many times the playbook, and if nothing is changed, nothing will be applied. If we change something in the configuration, for example, if we change the HTTP port in this case, only then the playbook will make some action on the server. This is important because if we would try to obtain the same behavior with a simple bash script, we should check a lot of things in order to avoid to change something. Instead, Ansible is able is idempotent because before playing a task, it collects the so-called facts that are the status of the machine, the context of the machine, and only if something is changed, it will run the various tasks. Otherwise, nothing will be played. Another important building block is the role, Ansible role. This is the best way to organize your playbooks because the roles allow you to structure the content of the recipes inside related vars, tasks, files, and handlers. It is important to see that the playbook that I showed in the previous slides, using roles, becomes very, very short because we are passing from this type of template to this, because all the tasks, the handlers, and the template files are organized into a folder tree that can be then pulled on GitHub or Ansible Galaxy and can be shared so that when you try to play on your host this playbook, the Ansible command will automatically download the role from Ansible Galaxy and will apply the playbook. For Indigo DC, we have a namespace in Galaxy Ansible. So if you go to the Ansible Galaxy website and browse the authors, filtering for Indigo minus DC user, you can find the list of Ansible roles that we have written and published on GitHub and Ansible Galaxy. To use them, to install them, you can simply use this command, ansible-galaxy install indigo-dc dot the name of the role. Another important tool that we are using in Indigo is Docker. Maybe many of you already know and use Docker. Docker is an open source engine that allow to easily create lightweight, portable, self-consistent containers from any application. It is a lightweight virtual machine. You can see it, you can see a Docker container like a lightweight virtual machine. Lightweight because inside a Docker image you haven't the operating system, but only the libraries and that are needed by your application. So the same container that a developer builds and tests on his laptop can run in any other environment, inside a virtual machine or on top of OpenStack, on public clouds, on hardware server, and so on. The main features of Docker are versioning, because you can commit your Docker images in a Git-like mode. Component reuse, because you can create new image starting from a base image, so you can publish your image and other people can build his own image starting from yours. You can share images using Docker registry. The most widely used Docker registry is Docker Hub, and there we are putting our images, Indigo images. For who has not written a Docker file yet, this is an example. A Docker file is a script that is composed of various commands, instructions, and arguments that are listed to automatically perform actions on a base image in order to create a new one. In this case, for example, we are starting from a bare Ubuntu Docker container and we are installing Nginx. Then we are providing as entry point of this Docker the Nginx executable that is started in daemon mode. Finally, we are exposing the port 80 so that when we run this Docker container mapping the port 80 on the host, we can access the Nginx, the web server service on that port. To build the image from the Docker file, we can use this command, docker build minus t, the tag of the image, and dot the path of the Docker file is missing here. I will correct the slide. This is a way to create a Docker image. Of course, you can also exploit the feature of Docker Hub of the automated build. Automated build is a very useful and powerful feature because you can create your repository on GitHub, put inside the repository your Docker file, and every time you commit some change on the Docker file, you get an automated build on Docker Hub. And it's very simple to create an automated build. You simply log in Docker Hub, you click on the Create button on right upper corner of the web page. Then you select automated build and you can link the Docker Hub repository to a GitHub repository, specifying the path of the Docker file. In this way you have created an automated build, and every time you commit some change in the GitHub repository, this will trigger a new build of the Docker image. Coming back to the manual, creation of the Docker image, once you have built your Docker image on your laptop, you have to publish this Docker image on the Docker Hub. If you don't use the automated build, you have to run this command, docker push and the name of the image you have previously used with the docker build command. Of course, you will be prompted with the credentials. You will have to enter the credentials to log in on Docker Hub to push this, your image. On the other side, if you want to use a Docker image, you have to use the command pull of Docker. So if you want to use the Amber Tools image that has been published in Indigo DataCloud app, the repository on Docker Hub, you have to run the command Docker pull Indigo DataCloud app Amber Tools. In this way, with this command, you download the Docker image from Docker Hub to the local Docker repository. You can check which images are on your local Docker repository using the command Docker images. Once the image has been downloaded, you can run a Docker container, you can start a Docker container from that image using the command Docker run. Docker run plus series of options. For example, you can specify if you want to run the Docker image in an interactive mode, if you want to run the Docker container in privileged mode, if you want to attach some volumes to your Docker container, and so on. There are a lot of options that you can find in the official documentation of Docker. Now we can move to the Orchestrator APIs. This is a short list of the main APIs that you can use to create a deployment, to list, to get the details of the deployment you have created, and to delete the deployment. To create a deployment, you can use a post request. You can shoot a post request to the deployment's endpoint of the orchestrator, or the PaaS orchestrator. With some parameters, the mandatory parameter is the template, which is a string that contains the TOSCA template of the deployment that you want to create. You can specify also the parameters that are the input parameters of the deployment. These are the parameters that appear in the input section of your topology template. You can get deployment details using a GET request to the same endpoint, specifying the UUID of the deployment that is one of the fields that are returned in the response of the create deployment request. So when you call the post API, you are returned with a JSON blob, and one of the first parameters is the UUID of the deployment that can be used to monitor the status of the deployment. Finally, you can delete your deployment with a delete request to the same endpoint deployment, specifying the UUID of the deployment. Full documentation of the REST APIs of the orchestrator are provided in this link, at this link.